5 minutes, I will be taking you through Mego, which is our project management tool from ThoughtWorks. So what I've tried to do is, I'm not just going to go in a regular demo fashion. I'm going to start with a couple of slides where I talk about what is the best way to measure progress, and then we'll get into the tool. So most of you must have heard about the infamous burndown chart. For those of you who haven't heard, it's a graphical representation that helps you measure progress against time. On the vertical axis, a lot of people actually swear by it, and I'll tell you why exactly we think it's not very useful. So what exactly? So let's say, what do we actually recommend instead, or how do we solve this problem? So let's measure business value, what the customers want, instead of actually measuring ours. And how do we do that? So you measure story completion. So what I have up here is, it could be story completion or even functionality completion, whichever way you prefer. I have, say, 5 functionalities at the bottom, and I can see how much have I actually achieved. So what is done? So you can see that show location is about 35% done. The edit search is about 24% done. I can see what's completed. I can see that 2 of my stories, the set location and save feature, are completed. And I can see the ones that I've not started as well. I can see what's not started. So you get complete visibility into what you've actually completed. And since people really love the concepts of having burn up and burn downs, so this is a very good substitute, to say, of the burn down chart. It's a burn up for a fixed date. What this does is it gives you your timeline in terms of your dates on the horizontal axis. And on the vertical axis, I've got the number of stories that are actually being worked on. So I can see there are 2 lines. The gray line is my scope line. It's a little muffled because of the screen, but the gray line is my scope line. And every single change in scope can actually be detected. So you can see every single crevice up here, which basically defines what scope change has actually taken place. You can see what you've done. So the red line reflects what you've done. So that's actually 41. So as of today, it tells me that's 41 points. That was my, 41 stories. That was my scope, and I finished 31 of them. And at a certain point, maybe 10 days before the deadline, you want to know what your state is going to be. Or even on the date of the deadline, you want to know what your scope is going to be. So you can actually have a kind of a fixed date up here where it tells you what you're going to, predict, rather, or what it's going to be like. So it tells me that currently you have 10 stories outstanding, and as of that date, you will have 8 stories outstanding. So that kind of is a flag for you. You need to probably go and talk to someone, see what needs to be done on that. And how does it predict? It basically uses your previous iteration velocity to see how you're going and predict based on that. So that's exactly what the fixed date chart does. So how do you track progress on your project? We basically use Mingle. Mingle is our project management tool. I think a couple of you have already come to our booth outside. For those of you who haven't, we have a booth outside. It's going to be there for the next 2 days as well, and you can come in and talk to us. I'm going to give you a glimpse of the tool as well. So my screen's a little off, but I'm going to invite a colleague of mine. So we're going to do a little role play to show you how exactly we work with Mingle. So Dashana, if you don't mind, just come. April. If I actually scroll up, and it tells me that the end date for my iteration is the 30th of March. That means I'm actually the 2nd of April. That means I'm going 2 days above the actual deadline. Now this is where I say, okay, I need to go and talk to my project manager, see what's happening. So I say, Dashana, this is the case. We're going to be 2 days over deadline. What should we do? So I spoke to the team. It looks like we might have initially misestimated, and that's causing this to happen. There's nothing that we can do from the team's perspective because they're working as hard as they can to deliver on time. Okay. So we have an option of maybe a resource or something else that we can get?
No, not in this case. just had a word with the RM, and that's not going to be possible on such short notice. I don't think we can increase. That's not.
Okay, so that basically brings us down to making a decision. What do we do? Do we have to deliver the functionality as a whole, or do we have to deliver on time? So that's a decision that I would need you to make, because there's only one of the two ways that we can go.
Alright. So for this particular customer, I think it's more critical to deliver on time. I don't think it's an option to push the deadlines. So that's surely something that we
Okay, so let's do one thing. Let us just look over what we currently have in our plan. So what I'm doing is I'm switching over to my iteration plan, where I can see my current iteration and the next iteration. I can see what I've planned for each of my iteration. The cards have been colored by priority. So during my planning, I actually know what my priority of the cards are as well. So I've got red for my high priority, yellow for medium, and green for my low. The bottom two are actually green. So I have some conversation with my PM. I say, blah, blah, blah. She says,
blah, blah, blah.
So we decide something, basically. And we decide, okay, we want to look into this card. So I click on it, and we have a quick view and some more blah, blah, blah that we talk about. And we decide, okay, this is the card that we probably need to move up to the next iteration. So all I do is drag and drop it into the next iteration. And now when I do that, and I go back to my forecast chart, it looks like the end of the date has actually changed. It's pulled back to the 28th of March, so you can actually see in the March if you can't see the number. So what's happened is, as I went and changed my planning, in real time you can actually see that reflect on your scope, as well as in your chart. So this really helps you during your planning meetings, initially as well, to have discussions with the customer where you need to plan certain things. You probably need some kind of metrics to show them for when you're going to be done. And this is a very good measure because it actually bases it on the previous iteration's velocity. And so that's basically what I wanted to show you compared to the burn down chart that most of us use initially. Thank you, Darshan. Let me just check how much time I have. So I do have another 2 minutes, I think, since we started late. I quickly wanted to show you the program management piece in Mabel. This is something that we added last year. So what the program management piece in Mabel talks about is we have a lot of large programs, and there are multiple projects reporting to these programs. But most of the time, we don't get visibility at that high level as to what's going on. I just called it a feature program. My feature program is basically something like an online site where we're working on putting together maybe Flipkart or something like that. I have a backlog of items, or we can call these objectives, because what we're trying to meet is a goal. Now, each of these objectives can be, they're at such a high level that you probably don't have any value for it. You don't have any estimate or any dollar value or anything that you can actually quantify. So what we've done is we've given a kind of relative measure that you can have for each of these. Maybe value is important to you. Maybe the size is important to you, or maybe a combination of both is important to you. So if that's important, then we have a ratio up here. So right now, I've just pre-given each one a value and size. So when I look at it, I can see, okay, this is the highest priority item that I want to pick up. But every single time when I have a long list, I don't want to just go through and see, oh, which one is the higher one. So I just want to prioritize them. So all I do is I drag and drop the items to make sure that they're in the highest priority list. And I can say, okay, the customer experience on the online site is what I'm concerned about. If I click on this, I can see that there's a value statement that tells me why this is important to me. And I say, okay, now I want to go ahead and plan it. So what I do is I say I want to plan it, and it takes me to kind of a timeline view where I can see all the months. You could also dual this to be a kind of your roadmap as well. Just make that smaller so we can see it. Yeah. And now I say, okay, I want to plan this, but before I plan this, I see that the two other items that are planned, but each one has a kind of alert on it. And what does this alert actually mean? So if I click on this, it tells me that there are 12 items of work, out of which 6 are completed. These 12 items are being worked on by 2 different projects, the email application and project 1. each one has an alert against it, so I can click on it and it will tell me the same kind of result where I can get as to when will I actually be done. But this is at more at a program level. So you can see how these projects are accumulating to get you that level of detail as well. So here in this case, maybe it's okay for me to stretch my deadline. So what I do is I just drag this out, and as soon as I drag it out to an acceptable time, you'll see the alert has actually disappeared because now it's finishing within time. Now the other interesting part of this is that when you have multiple projects working towards a program, each project is probably working in a different way. It's not going to be that every single project has the same estimation method or same methodology that you use. Maybe one project is waterfall while the other three are agile. How do you get information in that case? So what Mingle does, it allows you to have different projects working in different styles and still get that information. All you need to tell Mingle is what do you mean by done. So project A may mean acceptance is done. Project B might mean once testing is ready, it might be done for them. It might be something internal. So they say, okay, once we're done with testing, that might mean done for us. And they can still do their own estimation method, have their own teams, have their own ways. One could work on stories, the other could work on tasks, and you could still get this information out. I think I'm up to my time right now, so I hope I've excited you enough to know more about our products. We have our booth outside. You can get in touch with us, or we have an email address. You can write to us at studios@thoughtworks.com, and we will provide you with any other information you require. Thank you very much.
Now that we have mingled up a bit, we'll go a little swift with a swift Kanban demo. Just a quick check, how many of you have been attending any of the Kanban or Lean sessions? How many of you are actually doing Kanban? You've tried? You've tried physical boards, or anyone tried electronic board? All physical boards. And all physical boards. Okay, and have you faced any problems in physical board? You know, especially when you're collaborating with the teams in a distributed way. Okay, okay. Enough room space. Yeah, a lot of times I've seen teams complaining that you know we put our story cards and Janitor took it away. So the whole product backlog is gone.
We had about three teams sharing a single room, and we didn't know whose story was sitting.
All right. So what I'm going to talk about. Quick background. My name is Nitin. I work for Digitay. We are one of the leading ALM software development company. We have other tools which is on the enterprise side, but this one what we are focusing on is on Kanban. So this is one of the electronic Kanban product that will help you use Kanban in an electronic way, collaborate with the whole team distributed way. So I'm going to just quickly jump over no slides. I'll just quickly jump over to the tool and show you. Is it a little okay? Okay, so what you see is a Kanban board for a team. It's a dummy Kanban board which you pulled up. What you see on, one of the key principles of Kanban that you would have, noticed is you have to visualize your entire value stream. So our tool lets you visualize the value stream. What you see is, there's a ready lane, develop, validate, it could go on, till whatever you build. So you can have a build whole value stream built up, for based on the process that you have. Currently, rather than changing it, one of the key things that Kanban says that you try and visualize your existing process, and that is where you start, start with it. So you don't have to totally change to a totally new methodology. A little difference from Scrum, wherein it requires you to change, your roles, the way you've been working. Whereas Kanban says you start a little slow. You first visualize whatever you have been doing, using an electronic, using Kanban board typically. Once you've set up your visual, visualize your value stream, then you start seeing where are the bottlenecks coming up. So what we give you an ability that once you've defined your board, you can create, the work can come up in the first lane. It moves through the entire lane. At any point where it is stuck, you could go and highlight, you see a little red area right there. So it is telling you that there's something wrong there. There are a couple of cards which you see, there's something which is blocked. So if you're working, you've been working on something, something gets stuck, you can go and block it, and that sort of notifies the entire team. And sort of based on the Kanban principle, you can come over, huddle together, and try and fix that problem and maintain the flow. So at the whole goal that you're trying, using Kanban is to improve your flow, how the work has been progressing so far, and reduce your cycle time. That is the whole end business goal that you're trying to achieve. So the cycle time is nothing but right from your first lane till the last lane, how long did it take for any user story to go and move. I'm going to quickly show you some of the key features. Obviously, it could go in detail. Once you visualize your board, we give you a quick capability to go and define your cards. So you can have quick stickies created with a rich text description and define your user stories, cards. There are different types of coloring that you see. So you could define your own type of card. The yellow ones are stories, the red ones are bugs, the brown ones are gray ones are issues. So you can define your own classification. So when you look up the board, you should typically get all the information that you need to run your project or to manage your project. So we see a lot of user stories being worked upon. There are bugs in red here and there that you see. One of the key, one of the different principles of Kanban is, it's limiting your work in progress. So it says that you have to limit your work in progress and not multitasking, avoid multitasking. So we highlight the moment you can define a, based on your, let's say, developers, you could say at any point of time, I will let you only pick two cards. If you work on four different cards, ultimately you're going to lose productivity. So you can limit your WIP and it highlights you right on the board saying that there is a, violation which is happening. So go and fix it. Once you go through the whole, and just focus on key features, as you are going, there are cards. If you have more attributes, you could go, simply scroll up here. Just give me a minute. Okay, so you get to see the card priority, size, anything that you've been working on. If you've worked on a card, so if you see, there's a, this is a different sample of a Kanban board. Instead of going a lane wise, you could set up team member wise lanes. This is what we call swim lanes. So you can have team member one, what he's working on, team member two, what he's working on. So it is a very, very flexible Kanban board that you can go and split up in any ways. You can have vertical columns, horizontal columns, define, get as crazy as you want. Once you have done with this, the whole bunch of features that we provide in terms of adding your card, if I have to report a progress, I could simply move it. It is supported on iPad, so or on a touch screens. So we've seen a lot of customers using a touch screen where all they have is one touch screen in the middle of the team where the team sits, and they could just come over and say, I'm done with this card. So no more logging on to different tools and working with that. So that is a different paradigm that you could do. There is a lot of since a lot of users come from a Scrum background, there are a lot of capability to do a whole Scrumban. So you could do a bit of Scrum and a bit of Kanban. So we have a features to break down user stories. So you could build a hierarchy like this. So once you start with the project, if you have a big epic, or a big feature, you can build an entire hierarchy right there, and it rolls up as you're working on the card. It'll tell you how much you're done so far, and report the progress. We've gone beyond that. If you're working with multiple teams, especially, you could almost do a portfolio Kanban. So where you have multiple Kanban boards, you manage a higher level business objective on one board, and then push cards on a different board and still get the progress. So sort of a whole hierarchy of boards that you can go and create and manage your entire work visually. For each card, you could you can have tasks. Let me show you a sample. I said, so you could define your own classification. You could have user stories, you could have defects, issues. So there's different color coding that you see right up here. If you just, okay. So the yellow ones are user stories, the red ones are bugs, the gray ones are issues. But you could also define your own thing. So for example, if you're working with in a non-IT fashion, you could have something different which represents your card. Ultimately, a card represents your, the work you've been doing. If you're in a hardware shop, you could have cards like setting up some frequent installation that you do. So ops team can say installation is one because that is what they want to track the lead time against. You can. So let me just quickly show you. So if you pull up any card, you can have a set of subtasks to a card, and you'll see a progress, how much is done, not done, We've also built a little bit of, for some companies, you really want to do a bit of, easy time tracking, you can go and report actuals and, also get, progress based on that. I'm going to Just switch over to few more. Apart from that, there are a whole bunch of collaboration features built in. You can go and comment, put collaborative with your team members in our thread discussions. We're also building a chat feature that you can go and write here on a context of a card. You can go and chat with the team members that are working on the card and say, what is the progress? There's one more quick thing that I'll show you, and then I'll jump. Apart from these features, so for example, if you want to find out how long this card has been in progress, so you could flip the whole card back, and it'll give you an entire history of when was this card added in the backlog, when did it move to ready lane, how long it was sitting there. So you could track your work time, wait time across the entire value stream that you've been working on. So it gives you a very granular data as well as at a high level visual summary of what you've been doing. Apart from that, we have notifications. So these boards almost get live updates. If you're working in a distributed fashion, you have team members working all across. Any change that they do will be reflected immediately here. So you'll get an instant notification of what has been added, what has been changed, and stuff like that. I'll go to metrics. Some of the metrics that we can show quickly. So we have a whole bunch of metrics that support a cumulative flow diagram, how the whole flow has been working, where are the bottlenecks you can go and identify. You can track your lead time, how long typically each card on an average has been taking. We've also built a whole bunch of control charts, which can tell you based on 3 sigma limit, where are you, what are the number of cards which are going beyond your normal ranges. And you can go and drill down deep into that and figure out what went wrong, and then take corrective actions. One of the other things that we are working on, and I'll just give you a quick sneak preview. So this is so far about what is in your backlog and how you have been managing and how to improve it. We've gone one step beyond, and we are trying to work on something new. Wherein, if you have a backlog and what are the, so this is sample board. If you have a backlog and you know what are the resources that are working on your team, for example, different profile, you have a developer, designer, a tester, and you also, let's say you have 30 user stories and some defects and some issues. Now you want to know how quickly I can get this entire thing done. So what we're working on is, this is just an in-progress UI. You could actually go and just, let me 1 second. Okay, so it could simulate the entire stuff and show you, if you were to work with one developer and 30 user story card, is going to take you 1700 days to be able to finish it. Now you can play around with your entire data, that your live project data, and simulate and figure out what do I do so that I can crash my time. If I have to deliver in 3 months, how many resources of each profile do I need, and build the entire stuff based on that. So a lot of predictive capability is what you can get with this. So we've used a couple of standard algorithm, Monte Carlo algorithm, and so for each lane you could go and define what are the typical ranges that will take, so for how long the design takes, how long the testing takes, and based on that it will go and project it and build the whole thing. I'm just going to do a little variation right here. For example, if you see, I'm going to go and change the resource and say I have 13 resources. 13 developers. Okay, I got to save it. Just a minute. Now, if I run it, my cycle time will drastically reduce, because now we have played and said, if you have 13 developers, what will happen? Now, this is also a bad scenario. We could play around with it. If you see, a lot of things are getting choked in. Things are not evenly distributed. It's some of these lanes are still wide. So for example, things are getting stuck in a particular lane. So you'll be able to identify those problems beforehand and then make corrective actions. For example, now you can go and say, on some of these lanes, instead of designer, let me add one more designer who's going to help it. Or you could go and add more constraint. Say for example, a particular lane, I'm going to limit the work in progress. So accordingly, it'll limit the progress. So we'll not go in detail, but what we are working on is a whole bunch of constraints that you can put in based on your experience of managing the project so far, and based on that, it could go and predict what is going to be the finish time. All right, I'm not going to take much time. That's it. Thank you. Any questions on this?
One feedback, actually.
Sure.
See this progress screen. Significantly, I'm from a Scrum background.
Okay.
Have a task board in which we
post-it notes and try to track progress.
Okay.
We don't do on a user story level.
Correct.
We do on a task,
task level.
The reason being the granularity of the flow. It is more when compared from a task perspective.
Correct.
The moment you put from a user story perspective, you don't see much movement. You stay there for some
time. Sure.
And you don't see progress actually.
Correct.
But ultimately, when you drill into a user story, you will see
progress.
So
right.
This is not a complete snapshot of the progress, but it's only a subset of the progress.
Correct.
From a higher level.
Correct.
The more granular you put,
you get
clarity you get.
Correct. So we have some things in the pipeline, for someone to be able to see, because this is a higher level view, which is also important for in some scenario you can also have a task board where the granular data can be tracked in almost similar way.
If you have an correct option to move back and forth,
correct, exactly,
that is
exactly
great. But typically from a development perspective, mm-hmm, we see from a
task level, absolutely,
you don't see
input, absolutely, good feedback.
In a sprint, you may take very limited stories,
right? Correct,
so 3-4 stories which may have some 20
tasks.
So seeing the flow of the task is more important than seeing of the flow of the list.
Sure.
Yeah. Good evening to all of you. I've got a great challenge with me after a long day. It's very hard to keep you alive. We will try to have an interactive session here where I will not take you through any product complexities of products or all those things. We'll keep it very simple. We will interact together, find avenues where we can collaborate together, value add to your profession, value add to your career, and take you forward in your career, contribute to the community, and advance the profession which we are in. I am Jacob. I work with PMI. I'm a staff of PMI. My bread and butter comes from PMI. When I told bread and butter comes from PMI, PMI works on volunteering basis. I've got two volunteer leaders joining me, Rahul from Pune chapter, and also Ashish, who is a PMI champion, who joining me, who will be helping me with the presentation as we move along. We'll go with what is PMI's association with Agile, the credential of PMI, how we can collaborate together as an individual, and how we can collaborate together as from the organizational perspective. So this is what we are going to cover today. Demand for Agile, I need not talk to you. Then PMI's history with Agile, how we are associated together, how we developed ACP, which is certification from PMI. Overview of ACP, because a lot of people were coming and asking what are the requirements, prerequisites to become an ACP, how it is related to PMP, how it is compared to other credentials from PMI. We have got 6 credentials as of now. And how is the market reaction to PMI ACP, and how is it used in the industry, and how do we collaborate together? Let me take a step back. How many of you know about PMI? That's great. How many of you are credential holders of PMI? That makes my job easier. So how many of you are ACP? We have got 3 of them. That's great. Yeah, I think we need to take for ACPs, we need to take a step from that level to a different level. Maybe we will spend some time together later on, not for Rahul. So others know, I will guide you through ACP and all those things where Rahul and Ashish will be helping me. I will skip through a couple of slides. This is from the Gartner report, where about Agile adoption and Agile, how will be, as we move forward, how is the Agile adoption going to be? And PMI's history with Agile, PMI has been in touch with a lot of communities of Agile, with Scrum Alliance, with Agile Alliance worldwide. We have been having separate tracks in our congresses, which we hold worldwide, in Asia Pacific Conference, in North America Conference, and moving forward, even in India, for the national conference which we hold, hosted by the volunteers in PMI, we are having separate tracks for Agile, and that is how we started our interaction with the Agile community as such. As you may be aware, since a lot of people know about PMI, this is a not-for-profit body for advancing the profession of project management. So there are multiple ways by which PMI reaches out to the practitioners. One of the way is that geographically people come together, share knowledge. That's called chapters. We have got 8 chapters in India. Okay. Another way is we have got registered education partners who do training on a commercial and non-commercial basis. Organizations like Infosys, Wipro, who train their employees, or people who commercially train as a training institute, like in an NIIT, APTEC, all those things. That is one of the channels where we reach out to the practitioners for advancing the profession. The third way, multiple ways, one of the ways, another, the third way is people who are interested in one particular area come together virtually and discuss various issues related to that. It's a virtual community. We have got 36 communities of practice, one in the area of defense, another in the area of aerospace, general project management, risk management, all those things. And one of the community of practice is Agile. Okay, it is free for PMI members. Currently, we have got a traction of around 20,000 people worldwide. And in India, around close to around 2,500 people are associated with Agile community of practice. And is Ram here? We had a person who drives the community of practice, Agile community of practice in India. He's based out of US. What we do is that now people come together, share their knowledge, and one thing which in PMI we believe is that no problem in the world is unique. There would be somebody in the world somewhere who would have faced a similar kind of a problem, who would have undergone the pain, whatever is required, and come out with a solution. Good or bad solution is there. So it's only left to us, we need to reach to that guy, improvise on that, and use it to our benefit. And this is the avenue where you get an opportunity to do that, where people put across their problems, a subject matter expert comes and then shares the solution. So these are the activities a community of practice does. We hold networking, newsletters, sharing of knowledge, state your problems, a solution is provided. There may be people who are willing to come down and then discuss with your organization about the problem without any commercials attached to that. This is PMI's community of practice, Agile community of practice, activities of community of practice, the webinars, discussion forums, and these are the subject matter experts as far as Agile is concerned. Most of the people would be familiar to you. And in India as well, we are trying to develop a community of practice for Agile. It's not community of practice as such, a forum for Agile community. Maybe we will reach out to you. You can come to us. Contact any of us, any of the chapters, any of the volunteers, any of the PMI leaders, and then we can take it up further. Let me give you an overview of ACP. I would request Ashish and also Rahul to come across and then take you through ACP.
Right, so a year back, PMI started with a certification called as Agile Certified Practitioner. So this is primarily for people who are practicing Agile.